All right, so we're going to talk about some nitrogen sources and all the various forms. And the first thing that's important to understand is that, as was mentioned previously, it's a very complex cycle. It's mediated and run by a great deal of many different types of bacteria. There's some actinomyces, there's some fungi, there's, in some cases, there's highly specialized bacteria that do one thing. In other cases, there's a very wide range. So this slide was just sort of my attempt to show that your nitrogen can come in and say the organic form, a whole bunch of things happen, and the nitrogen comes out in plant available forms. And this sort of a slide is almost always organized and made much nicer in a textbook as a thing called nitrogen cycle. And you see all the various things that can affect the nitrogen cycle.
Muted.
So that's why nitrogen research is really messy. It can be terribly difficult to do because a lot of things affect it. And what we're going to look at here with the various fertilizer sources is this right down here, where we look at the plant available sources of ammonium and nitrate and how the different fertilizers affect that. So the basic things are that plants take up their nitrogen as nitrate, NO3, which is an anion, and ammonium, NH4, which is a cation. Yes, plants can take a little bit of urea in through the cuticular openings in the leaves in foliar application programs, but it's really not enough to sustain the high nitrogen needs of a turfgrass plant. So nitrate and ammonium are the big dogs. The fertilizer sources you apply may be organic sources. They may be something else. But regardless of how that material is applied, it could be decaying clippings. It could be the organic end that's in the thatch. It's got to be converted to the plant available forms of nitrate and ammonium. And again, that is done by a wide range of biological activity. So it is the microbial activity that really controls nitrogen availability in the soil. Now, we're going to divide the fertilizers, as been mentioned previously as well, into two big groups, and then we're going to take the slow release and sort of make some subsets. So our first group are soluble end sources. You're going to reach for these when you want to really grow some plants. You want plant growth, you want rapid plant response. You reach for a fertilizer that dissolves rapidly in the soil and is already in the nitrate or ammonium form. So examples of soluble fertilizers could include urea, our old stalwart ammonium nitrate, which of course is not used much anymore, ammonium sulfate, potassium nitrate, monoammonium phosphate. Those are all soluble and rapidly available sources. Because they're rapidly available, they may also run out in a quicker period of time, so you're going to reapply them more often. There are environmental issues, and in many states now, Florida being a main example, if it's a soluble source, you can't put on more than a pound of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet at any one time because of risk for the environment. It often is your cheapest source of nitrogen, because you're not paying extra for a coating or some type of a physical process to make it slow release. So, rapid green up, rapid response, soluble sources. The other big area is slow release sources. These sort of meter out the nitrogen and slowly provide that nitrogen over a long time to the growing turfgrass plant. They are certainly recommended for situations where you may not want to be removing a lot of clippings, or where there is an environmental concern, such as putting them on a very sandy soil where you could lose some of that nitrate to downward movement, which we call leaching, and there are human health effects with that. Tends to be a little bit more expensive. We consider them safer to use, less risk of burn to the plant, and there's different types of slow-release fertilizers. And those types, there's really two main types that we put under slow-release. The first is physically slow release. So think about a giant urea prill, like a ping pong ball. And then you tend, so that's soluble. That's going to dissolve. It's going to create a rapid turf response. But if you took that ping pong ball and you coated it with molten sulfur, or you coated it with wax, or you coated it with a thin layer of saran wrap or resin, you make it physically slow release. So something needs to act on those barriers either water or additional microbial decay for the nitrogen to slowly come out. And I do use the term urea because most of the original technologies, and the original one, sulfur coat urea, dates to the 1950s, and then you have polymer coat urea, resin coat urea, multi-coats, which may be a polymer and sulfur together. We are coating things other than urea now. Some of these technologies have gotten extremely advanced and extremely accurate. So you can get coated potassium sulfate. You can get coated ammonium sulfates. There's a wide range of technologies in this. Of course, they tend to cost a little bit more. The next big group of slow-release fertilizers is chemically slow-release. These are slow release because there's something in the process with how they were made. The most common one is what we call the methylene urea, urea formaldehydes. Now, in the true chemical definition of those are actually different based on the chain length of them. But we tend to, in turf, lump them all together and we call them MUUF products, methylene urea, urea formaldehydes. And what they are is chains of urea to formaldehyde, urea to formaldehyde, urea to formaldehyde that are made at that are synthesized in the chemical process. You get different chain lengths by reacting them for different times, different temperatures, and different pressures. Those chains of urea to formaldehyde have to be broken up by microbial activity and the nitrogen comes out. So these are slow release by the fact of their chain length. The longer the chain, the slower the release. The shorter the chain, the quicker the release. Another completely different family is IBDU, isobutylene diurea. And it's not used much anymore, which is kind of a shame, because to make the nitrogen come out and to work on the slow release characteristic, it's only activated by water. There's a hydrolysis. And so it works really well in colder, wetter conditions where you may have a low soil microbial activity. But I don't see IBDUs being used all that much. It's expensive and it's hard to find. So the big chemical slow release materials are the methylene ureas. Now the third grouping is not really allowed to be called slow release. Instead, we sort of have this trade name of stabilized nitrogens. And what these are is they are urea to which either or both, and this is wrong, sorry, I should have corrected it, okay, they either have a nitrification inhibitor added to them and or a urease inhibitor. Now, this technology has been around for a long time, but they're kind of coming back into the marketplace in the past 5 to 6 years. So here's some examples. Here is a methylene urea, chemically slow release. So this is the one that's the chains of formaldehyde to urea. You notice here, like this little prill has kind of been cut open. It's still slow release because it's chemically slow release. It's not got a coating around it. Here is a polymer slow release. There's a wax or a polymer coating the prill of urea, and here you see one that's kind of been clipped open. So really, that would be the same as soluble material because it's been cut in half. Here's straight urea. This is when you coat it with the wax or the resin or the polymer. And here is when you coat it with the sulfur. You notice how these prills have lots of different sizes. That's because the sulfur coating technology tends to be a little less accurate, is a bad word. It just has a lot of different sizes within those prills. Now, what does that all mean for how you see color responses over time? Well, these are very typical kind of graphs that we make or figures when we do our research. So here we go from 1 week all the way up to 10 weeks. And we tend to analyze this stuff over 10 or 12 weeks because we want to look at long-term response. On this side, you have the color. Now, in real life, we rate from a low score of 1, which is completely brown turf, to a high score of 9, which is a mythical dark green. We don't rate halves. Those halves are in here just so the scale makes better sense. So we rate from a 1 to a 9, and if I'm pretty happy with it, I look at the turf and I say, you know, I don't think we need more fertilizer. We give it a score of around 5. All right, so remember, here's urea right here, right? Soluble, quickly released, you're going to see very rapid green up. In fact, when we do foliar work with urea, we can see a greening response within 4 hours. So 1 week after we applied it, we've got our absolute darkest color of 7, and then it does nothing but decrease in color over time. By comparison, here we have a neutraline, the light green. This is a chemically slow release. It's a methylene urea. And it's a very long chain product. Remember, the longer the chain, the slower the release. And this is very typical. You see a little bit of a color response and then sort of a background maintenance just about at, clean this up a little bit. You sort of see a background maintenance of color with this long chain fertilizer product. It's not going to grow a lot of turf. It's not going to heal in bare spaces, but it's going to give you a nice background color. Now, here we have a polyon product, okay? The red squares. Notice that this is a physically coated material. So it's a prill of urea to which they have sprayed a resin coating. And you look here, week one, week two, week three. It takes 3 weeks until we've got a satisfactory turf greening response. So again, you are using this in your home landscape program and your clients want to see a rapid green up, this is maybe not the best product to look at. Certainly, what you would consider doing is combining it with a little bit of urea up front for that rapid green, and then look at the benefit on the backside, week 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Look at how you have a retention of green color as compared to the soluble end source of urea, which by now, at week 8, is no longer giving you the green color you want. So these stabilized nitrogen sources, a little bit more detail. Again, they're not marketed nor properly sold as a true slow-release fertilizer. So what do? You take urea and you add the nitrification inhibitor, which is called DCD, dicyanidiamide, and or you add the urease inhibitor, which is N-N-butyl thiophosphoric trimid. All right, that is sold in the turf market under the trade names Uflex and Umax. Now, there's another completely separate product which you may read about. It's called Nutrisphere. It's a completely different product. It's a maleic iconic copolymer. So they don't have anything in common. They operate by different chemistries. They're different. It would be like if this was a herbicide slide, this part here talks about dicamba, and then I switch to talk about 2,4-D. Different modes of action, different things. But in both cases, they are advertised as nitrification inhibitors. Now, what are we talking about? Okay, the nitrification inhibitor, what it does is it affects the enzyme activity that converts ammonium to nitrate. Now, why do we want to not have that happen? Because if it stays as ammonium, see that plus charge on the ammonium? It won't leach. You won't lose it out of your rooting profile, potentially to groundwater. So that's the one thing. That's the nitrification inhibitor property. The second part is the ammonia volatilization inhibitor part. And that is stops the activity of the urease enzyme, which is the loss of the surface-applied ammonium to the atmosphere, is NH3 gas. Now, this can be substantial in situations where you apply urea, and largely only urea, except in very high pH soils, and that's a topic for another whole lecture. But if you surface apply urea or urea derivatives like UAN solutions to the surface and you do not incorporate them, our work has shown you could lose up to 20% of your applied nitrogen from volatilization with surface applied urea that is not incorporated. So these UMAX, UFLEX products have the urease inhibitor in them that stops that process. So, you got two things, nitrification, which is the first thing, and then the volatilization inhibitor, which is the second. Now, this is the nitrification. So again, what we're doing here is looking at the conversion of ammonium to nitrate. There's very specific bacteria that do this. There's two. There's not a wide range of things that do this. So ammonium is here in this left hand. Okay, so here's your soil ammonium. Nitrate is here on the right. So unaltered urea, just straight urea, the ammonium goes down, 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 down as it is converted to nitrate. That is a process called nitrification. So if you put in a nitrification inhibitor, it stops that because it messes up the enzymes that make it run. So here it is with the nitrification inhibitor, the green dots, notice it stays as ammonium. And it does that for about 5 weeks, because here you see the ammonium staying up, which means it's not making nitrate, and we're not measuring any. And then after about 5 weeks, the material wears out, the enzymes kick in, regular nitrification procedure, here comes the nitrate. So we know they work. This was all done in a laboratory experiment. We know they work. What about the volatilization side? So remember, we got these two different inhibitors that are in these stabilized nitrogens. It as well does the job. So here is straight urea. Put the urea on the surface, didn't water it in, didn't do anything. In over 20 days, this is a high one, we typically see about 20% of the nitrogen we apply lost to the air. When you add the UMAX UFLEX product, the volatilization inhibitor, you see a decline. See here, day 3, day 5, day 7, day 10. So what you see is not, you don't see a decline in total ammonia volatilization. It's still going to happen, but what it does is it delays it. See how it's lower for about 10 to 14 days? At the end of the study, cumulative nitrogen loss from volatilization, it's about the same, but you get a window of delay. And what that window of delay lets you do is maybe hope for some rain to incorporate that urea. Or maybe you get your irrigation going to incorporate that urea and get it so that it won't volatilize or go to the air as ammonia gas. Now, again, this is in a laboratory study. What about the field? So we moved it to the field, and instead of 20 days, we ran it for 10 weeks. Why did we do this? Well, one, we look at these products, particularly things like the resin-coated polyons and the resin-coated, sulfur-coated XCU, and the UMAX, which is the product that's a stabilized source with the nitrification inhibitor and the volatilization inhibitor. Well, all these are sold and advertised of 8 to 10 weeks of color response and longevity. So while a 20-day study was interesting, we wanted to see if we were going to get peaks of nitrogen loss from volatilization at week 4, week 6, week 8. We wanted to know what happens when those prills sit out there for 10 weeks with mowers and foot traffic and all kinds of things. And the answer is not much. Your volatilization, if it's going to happen to any substantial degree, is usually within about the first week. And all of our work is showing that. It's really a very sudden effect. Again, surface-applied urea had substantial amounts of nitrogen loss to volatilization. Using a sulfur coat, resin coat, significantly reduced that, as did the use of a fertilizer with the volatilization inhibitor. So it did its job in the field in a real-life situation. Down here, you see the polymer coat product really worked well. Now, we still had loss in week 2. Why? Because it didn't rain until right here. And you see what happened after the rain? Goes down. One thing that was interesting is we didn't see a lot of spikes. Nothing spiked up significantly in N loss as we went along, which tells us we weren't getting damaged prills or broken prills, or the mower wasn't messing up the prill integrity. They were doing their job. Now, one of the things that's important to realize is that in many cases, we see the environmental benefits, reduced leaching, reduced volatility loss. We don't always see those benefits come back to us in color. Because when you think about turfgrass research, what do you measure? You know, corn work is easy, bushels per acre. Cotton work is easy, lint yield. It's hard in turfgrass. And one of the easy measurables is color. As I've shown you before, we do a scale of 1 is brown and a 9 is mythical dark green. So all here's urea, granular, and then these two are the stabilized end sources with the nitrification inhibitor and the volatilization inhibitor. And over time, you see that everything just has a long, slow, linear decrease in color over the 10 weeks of this test. And between the sources, you never have any really consistent difference in color. So using these two materials, you don't see them up here, you know, as compared to urea, providing a long-term color response. Now, when we look at them, here we have another study. So the open circles are straight urea, and the blue circles are urea with a nitrification inhibitor added. I'm not sure which, it was experimental. And you see again that there's not any strong differences. These were applied every 5 weeks. So their fertilization, their fertilization, their fertilization, their fertilization. But one of the things that's interesting is the urea was applied at 1 pound per thousand, and the urea and the additive, the nitrification inhibitor, was applied, let's see if I can draw this, there you go, that's terrible, 0.85 pounds per thousand. So we got the same color response when the additive was applied at a lower rate. Now, if your suspicious brain is working right now and you're thinking, well, yeah, Beth, but this treatment is missing. You need a third treatment to really see. You need urea alone at that same low rate, at the 0.85 rate, because then you can really see if the additive is providing benefit at the lower rate. We've done this a little, and again, this is some interesting work where we're seeing the benefits not for extended color response, but we get the same color at a lower nitrogen application rate. Now, another whole area of fertilizers that are out there are these Nutrilife products, which are sort of a bio-enhancement product. And if, again, here's our color stuff, so we go from the start of the experiment all the way to 91 days, so there's 11 weeks, 12 weeks, 13 weeks, and our 1 through 9 relative color. And if all I did was show you this color curve, you kind of go, that's not really doing much, you know, maximum color at about 2 weeks, and then it declines over time. And yes, but recognize that when you do research, this is one time, one location, one grass. And certainly I could look at this and go, well, you know, let's do it again. Let's see if we get any differences. But these are compared the same rate. I went back and checked my protocol. These were both applied at 1 pound of N per 1,000 square feet. But, again, color is only one measure. What else do you think about when you define a quality turf grass? It could be ball roll, shoot density, root density, clipping yield, recovery from being worn bare. Quality. There's tons of different things we measure in turf, which makes it challenging to do research. An example is this same study where we didn't really see a whole lot of color response, but we went on ahead and collected a lot of other data. So here is the Nutrilife, not added, here's your control, added at a gallon per ton and added at 1.5 gallons per ton. So we collected clipping yield, a measure of basically our turf harvest. And this is really interesting data because, oops, I turn my pen back on. There we go. Okay, so here we have an August 10th clipping yield, 2.8 grams per plot, 5.1 and 8.3. So as the NLAF addition increased, so did the yield of clippings. But what makes this more interesting is you see how there's a different letter next to each mean? So 2.8 grams has a C, 5.1 has a B, 8.3 has an A. That means it's significantly different. So I can say with complete statistical confidence that in every one of these clipping harvests, as the addition of NLAF went up, as that rate increased, we saw a significant increase in clipping. Now, those are four harvest dates, 1 year. We did a couple other harvest dates, and we didn't have a significant effect. But it's enough interesting data to make you want to continue to look at what these materials are doing. Shoot density. We take cores 2 inches in diameter, and we hand count all the shoots in the core. Again, adding NLAF at 1.5 gallons per ton significantly increased the shoot density as compared to not adding any at all. See how that has a B and that has an A? So again, we've got different letters indicating a significant increase in shoot density. Now, what makes it something that we want to further pull apart is we also take root weight. In July, there was no significant difference. See all those A's? In September, in fall, as we go into dormancy, we actually had decreased root weight when we added the NLAF. And that's not a particularly surprising finding. We're going into fall with Bermuda grass. We're entering dormancy. That plant's not interested in putting on additional clipping yield like we clearly show it will. That plant wants to think about going into dormancy. So this tells us we need to look at some timing effects and other things. But the upshot of this 1 year of data at one location is that you've seen some very positive benefits, and it's something we need to explore further. So some final thoughts on this. You need to green and grow turf. You know, I always tell my athletic field guys, they're staring at their worn, slap-out football field in the middle of June, and they know the first week of August they've got a football demonstration jamboree. They need to be reaching for soluble nitrogen sources to green and grow turf. But if there are environmental stipulations, or you simply want a background green with minimal clipping production, slow-release products are absolutely beautiful and they fit in very well. On our warm season grasses, you don't want to go above a pound of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet per application. And honestly, that's a little bit on the high side. We were talking about this before we started, that most of our commercial home lawn fertilizers, that if you follow the instructions on the bag, the current rate at which those are being put out is about 3/4 of a pound to 0.8 pounds of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet. And a lot of that is predicated on the legalities in states like Florida to how much you can put out at any time. It is not worth putting out 2 to 3 pounds of soluble in thinking you're going to grow a lot more turf, because all you're going to do is shorten up your roots, scalp the crap out of your turf, and grow too much clipping, and you're just going to make hay. Figure out how much you're paying for your nitrogen. Figure out your cost per pound then. And I do think there's plenty of research and data starting to show that we're seeing an emerging science in the bio-enhanced products that are out there. And I really do think that in the next 5 to 6 years, we're going to see more and more of these products with demonstrated benefits for turfgrass management.